So I'm Arnie Eisen, Chancellor of JTS, and I want to welcome you all to JTS for the Hendren and Rapaport Memorial Lecture. Some of you may be here for the first time, and we want to send a particular greeting to you. Others may not know that JTS, for over a century now, has been in the business of supplying North America with a vision of what Judaism is and could be. We've been doing the cutting-edge historical research to give us the varied and deep knowledge of the Jewish past that's necessary for charting the Jewish future. And we've been training leaders, rabbis and cantors and educators and others who have been committed to implementing this vision. It's amazing to think about it, but if we count the modern history of JTS as starting with Schechter's arrival in 1902, Neil Gillman has been involved with the history of JTS for over half of that history of JTS. So we I'll say a few more words about Neil and about this evening in his honor in a moment. But before that, I want to say a word or two about the Rapaport Lecture. This annual lecture was endowed in 1982 by Mrs. Selma Rapaport Pressman, a past president of the Women's League for Conservative Judaism, and a longtime member of the JTS board in memory of her late husband, Henry N. Rapaport. Henry Rapaport was a distinguished attorney and committed Jew. He served as president of Temple Israel in White Plains and later as, yes, well represented here tonight, we know, and president of the United Synagogue. He was an active member of the JTS board and a generous benefactor to its scholarly programs. I'm pleased to recognize the presence with us this evening of Henry Rapaport's sons, Michael Rapaport, his wife Joanne, and David Rapaport and his wife Deborah, and to thank the Rapaport family for its generous support. And of course, I would also like to welcome in person the man we are honoring this evening, Neil Gillman, and the members of his family who are joining us this evening. And while we're in the welcoming mode, we want to say a warm hello to Rabbi Paula Macdrell and the group from the Orangetown Jewish Center. Yes. And at this moment, it's my pleasure to call on Michael Rapaport for greetings from the family, and then we'll proceed to the rest of this evening's program. Michael?
Thank you, Chancellor. Friends, my mother, Selma, is unable to join us tonight, but sends her greetings. She endowed this lecture in memory of her husband and our dad, Henry N. Rapaport, in the hope and expectation that it would be of value to the seminary and an inspiration to her children and grandchildren, both of their interest and commitment to their Jewish heritage. Mom and Dad were leaders of their lay organizations and committed members of the seminary family. It is this tradition that we meet in, it is in this tradition that we meet tonight in the ongoing and continuous search for our common goals through the philosophy of our common religion, a culture to live by and cherish.
So how does one celebrate and pay tribute to a figure like Neil Gillman as the day of his actual retirement approaches? We figured that Neil has enough fountain pens. We also figured that he has enough books. But what he can never get enough of is lively, high-level discussion of Jewish theology. This is a man, after all, whose recent book is called Doing Jewish Theology. So we decided that we would honor Neil this evening by doing Jewish theology and in doing it in the way he liked it done, honestly, in a lively fashion, in a fashion that causes us to speak about real issues that real people face in ways that real people can understand. Because one of the marks of Neil's achievement is to operate on the very highest levels of academic theology and have a gift for translating that theology to the ordinary reader and convincing that reader that he and she is fully capable of embarking on the theological project for themselves. Some of you may not know that Neil is a native of Quebec City and graduated from McGill in 1954 and then made his way to JTS partly because of the inspiration of Will Herberg. He received his PhD in philosophy from Columbia University in 1975, but by then had already begun teaching at JTS as a member of the faculty. And so for over the course of 5 decades, Neil has confronted JTS students and faculty and alumni and trustees and anyone he came in contact with and lay people throughout the conservative movement and beyond with the importance of thinking constructively, personally, honestly about God and all the major issues connected to God. His passion, in his words, is stirring the theological pot. And Neil has done that for many audiences. I'm sure many people in this room have thrilled to his books like Sacred Fragments, Recovering Theology for the Modern Jew, his book about conservative Judaism, his really courageous book about a subject that modern Jewish thought doesn't often tackle, namely what happens to us after death. And Neil wrote a book called The Death of Death, Resurrection and Immortality in Jewish Thought, and a book, Traces of God, Seeing God in Torah, History, and Everyday Life. I've already mentioned the most recent book, Doing Jewish Theology, God, Torah, and Israel in Modern Judaism. And this is a man who is not only revered but loved by generations of JTS students and colleagues, a man who single-handedly sometimes kept the flame of theology alive in an institution which has the word theological in its name but didn't often give the enterprise the full respect that it deserved. For all of this and more, we're here to honor Neil tonight. I'm going to introduce him later on with some words by his colleagues, but before turning to the panel, I just wanted to read one appreciation by his friend and colleague, Rabbi Meir Rabinowitz. Quote, his teachers respected him and saw the promise of an exceptional scholar and thinker. His colleagues admire him as an innovative and passionate teacher of philosophy and theology. His students are inspired by his ability to engage them in theological exploration and religious growth. And the Jewish community has been enriched by him as he has guided so many hundreds of individuals to begin to wrestle with the important questions of faith and belief. Rabbi Gillman has forced us to put God front and center in the drama of Jewish life, and the impact of his work and his close relationship with colleagues and students is felt around the world. Now, we wanted to demonstrate the liveness, the compelling, up-to-date character of this work that spans half a century. And so we have put together a panel that you see before you this evening. The panel is going to speak in as informal a way as we can manage, very briefly. We will then entertain questions and discussion from the audience, and we will then turn the program over to the man who will have the final word this evening, Rabbi Neil Gillman. Rabbi Gordon Tucker is the senior rabbi of Temple Israel Center in White Plains, New York, where Mr. Henry Rapaport, Zichrono Livracha, served as synagogue president. Rabbi Tucker served as dean of the JTS Rabbinical School for 8 years. He has also served for many years as adjunct assistant professor of Jewish philosophy at JTS. He has published numerous articles on Jewish philosophy and law, as well as Heavenly Torah, a translation of and commentary on Abraham Joshua Heschel's 3-volume work, Torah Min HaShemayim, on rabbinic theology. Rabbi Julie Roth is executive director of the HillelCenter for Jewish Life at Princeton. Her passion for pluralism, for Jewish life, and for multiculturalism makes campus work an ideal match for Rabbi Roth. Previously, she worked for Hillel on the local and international levels, and she joins our panel as a proud, loving student of Rabbi Neil Gillman, her teacher. And I will moderate in my capacity as Jew, conservative Jew, scholar of modern Jewish thought, who in that capacity has read Neil Gillman's work avidly for decades and been thankful to him for the companionship he has given me along the sometimes lonely path of creative Jewish thought, and of course as Chancellor of JTS. So, we resolved that we're going to try to do this in as informal and conversational way as possible, although rest assured that this is not merely a schmooze our panelists have prepared for the evening. Gordon, what would you say in your various roles, rabbi, theologian, Jew, is the most valuable, perhaps the most live and compelling aspect of Neil Gilman's contribution to this enterprise? What strikes you as most important right now?
Let me just untangle this for a second here before I get into trouble. Okay, I think I just want to say at the outset, before I answer the question, and I'm sure I'm speaking on behalf of my friend and colleague next to me, actually friends and colleagues next to me, that we could spend the whole evening actually talking, giving chapter and verse about the many things that that Neil Gilman has done for us and for the sharpening of our thinking. And it would leave no time for some of the thoughts that we are charged with giving you tonight. So I just want to say at the outset that virtually everything that I'm going to say is touched and colored in one way or another by conversations and by other learning experiences that I have been privileged to have with Neil over many decades now. I think Neil's most important thing in most general terms has been that something that he has said on a number of occasions and written on a number of occasions, which is that Jewish philosophy flowers when Judaism itself becomes problematic. And it is, in one sense, a truism. In another sense, it's a very important kind of consolation that problematics in getting life and life's experiences to fit with one's theology, which he always pressed students on, is an opportunity. It's an opportunity for Jewish philosophy and Jewish theology really to flower and to move into new territories in response to those challenges. The human condition has always been such that we experience very painfully the limitations of our world, limits on our power, the finality and inevitability of death. These very experiences, which many parts of Jewish theology were created to address by having us embrace the idea of a transcendent being, have those same problems with the human conditions have led large segments of humanity in modern times to despair of the possibility of any transcendence that could redeem our finite lives from meaninglessness. And it has become a particular problem, I think, in the modern age, and Neil is really among the premier people in not only in this institution but in other places to call our attention to it. If I can, let me just take a moment, because I think there's a very, very good way of encapsulating this. I'm going to give you a paraphrase of words that most of you are familiar with that were put in the mouth of one of the characters in Anski's The Dybbuk, Reb Azrielka. So here's the paraphrase. Out of all the places in the world, one can ascend the ladder of holiness of space by moving inward from the land of Israel to Jerusalem to the Temple Mount to the Holy of Holies. Out of all the people in the world, one can ascend a ladder of holiness by moving inward from the Jewish people to the tribe of Levi, to the priests, to the high priest. And out of all the moments of time, one can ascend a ladder of holiness by moving through the festivals and Sabbath to the Sabbath of Sabbaths, which is the Day of Atonement. And finally, out of all the words in the world, one can ascend the ladder of holiness by moving through the Hebrew language to the words of the Torah, to the Ten Commandments, and then to the ineffable name of God. That there is a privileged frame of reference in space does not seem plausible to us anymore, given our science and our culture. That there's a privileged center of humanity strikes us both as morally mischievous and as incompatible with an objective view of the world from outside ourselves. Is it possible there's a privileged moment of time as well in a world in which we know the many movements that time measures relate to one another in ridiculously inelegant, unaesthetic, and apparently random fractions? A solar year is 365.24219 days, and even that is an approximation. And finally, can the sanctity, not to mention the efficacy of words, be maintained in a culture in which the very notion that they have objective meaning is routinely rejected? So what rolled off the tongue very easily in previous days, that there were these inherent ladders of holiness that could move us beyond our finite lives and give us meaning, are all under attack today, and in many ways for good reason, and for good solid philosophical reasons. I think if I had to just to begin this discussion, I think Neil's great contribution has been in one way or another to call our attention to all of those and to challenge us to find some way to put meaning in our lives in a way that's appropriate to our science, our culture, and our state of knowledge.
Yeah, I know that Neil's often been compared to Kaplan, one of his teachers, and you put your finger on one of the apt comparisons, which is this honesty, this sobriety. Face it, you can't deny these issues. They're not going to go away, so face up to them. And it's often really refreshing and reviving to see that kind of honesty in a Jewish theologian, because it gives you the hope that if we face up to the problems, we might actually be able to solve them. So can we solve them? Does Neil help us solve them?
I think Neil does help point us in certain directions. What I hope we can talk about a little bit tonight or at least three areas that I think are critically important for the future of theology that Neil has already thought a great deal about, taught a great deal about, and written some about. One has to do with the importance and the trusting of religious experience, it is religious experience that historically really has created religious communities, and that much more than the systematics and a priori categories that marked Jewish theology in earlier ages. Is going to be critically important, and here I'm speaking particularly as a congregational right. rabbi, and understanding what it is that is not only raising theological problems and religious yearnings, but what the key to their solution is. So religious experience, I think, is one of those things. The second is something that's a little tricky, given that Neil has written and taught so much about myths and metaphors, but I know that behind that is a recognition that the acknowledgement that much of our language is not pointing to a real metaphysical reality in a very naive sense has to be accompanied by some way of reconstructing an external reality that our religious language is really about. And that is something that I know Neil has appealed to in Paul Ricoeur's terms as the second naivete. Thomas Mann referred to it as eating a second time from the tree of knowledge in order to fall back into a state of innocence. That there is a second level that we have to get to in terms of what philosophers would call metaphysical realism. And the third thing, I think is very much related to that, which is that we do have to find a basis for Jewish thought that is going to go beyond simply the practices and the norms that we so often take as being constitutive of what Jewish theology and Jewish community and continuity is about. Because it will ultimately not satisfy religious yearnings. So this getting beyond the substitution of whether it is a legal system or whether it is cultural ties, the substitution of those for the problematics of finding a reference to our religious yearnings is something we need to get beyond.
We're talking about God.
We're talking about God.
Just want to be sure.
Yeah.
Julie, you represent another generation of Jewish thinkers, and equally important, your job calls upon you to speak to your generation and those even younger to you every day. And I have to confess that I got excited about Julie's presence on this panel when I read a Yom Kippur sermon she delivered, which represented a masterful translation of some very difficult theological concepts of revelation and authority at mitzvah to a college crowd. She made it compelling. And is the sort of enterprise that Neil has been engaged in, do you think, relevant and useful in reaching this young generation of Jews and catching them up in the experience of being a thoughtful Jew?
Just last week, I met with a group of graduate students to talk with them about what they most wanted to learn Jewishly. And the number one thing they voted to learn about was different conceptions of God. And the second thing that they voted to learn about was why be Jewish and why be religious in the first place. And that's no different than the undergraduate students that I work with. I have coffee with a student. I try to have coffee with a student once a day. We call them coffee dates in Hillel. Talk to them about what's on their mind Jewishly. And for many of them, they need to figure out how to sort through their own beliefs about God, about authority in the tradition, in order to find their place and decide how to be Jewish on their own. So I definitely find in my work that it's relevant. I just want to take one step back and say to my teacher, Neil Gillman, that what I admire most about you as a teacher and as a theologian, and what I think your greatest contribution has been to the field of Jewish theology, is that you model and teach personal theology. And during my time at the seminary, we sat together for a semester and did an independent study on a theology of healing. It was during a time when I was recovering from a very difficult hand injury. It had been so bad I couldn't take notes in class. I couldn't even carry the food in the cafeteria on my own cafeteria tray. And I was struck going into the year that I studied with you about why it was that here I was, a rabbinical student, a religious person. I went to Minyan, I was on the Misha Beirach prayer, and yet God was so distant from me during that period of healing. It was almost tangential, these two things. And so we sat, and together you helped me discover new metaphors for God, a new personal theology that could speak to me at that particular moment in my life. And what I took most from your book, Doing Theology, Jewish Theology, is that you model that in how you write also. You open with a chapter on what you believe, but then you don't gloss over the fact that you've changed what you think over the years. In fact, you say emphatically that teachers need to model that vulnerability of thinking one thing and then reconsidering, of putting themselves, their vulnerabilities, their achievements, their failures into the arena. And I think that's what gave me permission to define my personal theology at that particular moment in an ongoing way. And I think that's what gives students and young people and people of all generations the courage to do that today. So in terms of college students and young people, I'm going to put myself in the young people category. We've got a range on campus. I've got the full range, from unaffiliated, secular, orthodox, conservative, reform, just Jewish, popular way of talking about it. And the vast majority of them cannot accept a literal understanding of God. And for me in my own life, I appreciate that. I feel like I was born believing in God. I came to believe in God maybe primarily because of my father's belief in God, but my father is also a Holocaust survivor, and I grew up with the story of his working on Shabbat for the first time by Nazi gunpoint, and realizing during that day that he wasn't struck down as he thought he would be, as he was taught in Cheder, for breaking Shabbat, and how that changed his literal understanding of what God is, but still believed that God exists, right? So I grew up with that, but it wasn't until I became more familiar with your work and with the way you talk about myth as a way of acknowledging that as liberals, we don't believe that God literally wrote the Torah, that it's a literal world of God, but yet it's not simply untrue, it's actually compelling and sacred and powerful because it is the organizing story of meaning by which we organize our lives. And that's what I wanted to convey to my students on Yom Kippur when I talked to them. I wanted them to know that I, as a rabbi who tries to be traditional in my practice in different ways, I don't believe God actually cares about whether or not we spend money on Shabbat or whether or not we eat McDonald's cheeseburgers. Rather, I think God cares about whether we live our lives with a sense of purpose and whether or not we have gratitude and seek forgiveness, whether we have a balance in our lives between work and rest, whether or not we are ethical and compassionate and concerned about justice. And I find when I talk to students that when they hear that larger message, that God could care not about the details, but about sort of the bigger picture, even if you want to talk about that metaphorically, it speaks to them and it starts to give them permission to figure out what they're going to do now that they're no longer living in their parents' house, whether they're just undergraduates who are just newly out or the graduate students who for a very long period of time are not going to get married and have children and join synagogues. What choices are they going to make? And I find that this concept of myth allows them to sometimes choose on a case-by-case basis or on a spectrum, what of the meaning speaks to them, and to take it one step at a time, much as I did when I was taking on the observance of Shabbat when I was deciding if I was going to come to JTS, and I found out that was a bit of a prerequisite for coming here. I think that college students are well aware of what Dr. Neil Gilman says, that ultimately in the modern age, the authority lies in ourselves. Hillel has done research on a national level about what college students today think about a variety of things. And what they found is that young Jews today in their 20s and 30s, they're not motivated by guilt or by fear or any inherent sense of authority. What they're motivated by is meaning. And I know from talking to my mother that, you know, it's people of all generations who feel that way, but I think that the pull of nostalgia or tradition that maybe an older generation feels because they were closer to it is not as strong for young people today. And I work with students who carry around iPods and order exactly the kind of coffee they want at Starbucks to the very detail. They don't even have to buy an entire album of music. And so their context is completely a personalized one, and they're looking to find the meaning, in a sense, one song at a time to download on their iPod to mix up in their own way. And that meaning has to be compelling, has to make the case for itself, but it also has to allow them to be distinctly Jewish, but also not insular. Because the same study from Hillel found that while they're searching for meaning, they don't want to only celebrate it with their Jewish friends. They want to celebrate it with their Jewish and their non-Jewish friends.
So then, let me ask both of you, I'm going to turn now to Gordon, having heard Julie. Are we in a different cultural moment now, perhaps a moment more receptive to Neil's enterprise? We seem to be at a moment where intelligent people are willing to say they take the question of God seriously. This is not a ridiculous question or one you have to do hush-hush. It's something that you can talk about in educated circles again. And it's a moment where we don't necessarily see an opposition between truth, scientific, objective truth on the one hand, and the sort of personal myth and metaphor that Julie said her students are seeking, which Neil has been helping us to seek for a generation now.
Yeah. I think part of what Julie was just describing is undeniably true, that there is a kind of an a la carte quality to the world of culture broadly speaking now. Whether that is ultimately going to satisfy or not is a serious question that sociologists more your field are going to have to try to guide us to answer. I do see a congregation that has a somewhat broader age range than my alma mater for graduate school. an openness to be talking about God. This is absolutely not a hush-hush subject, and it gets spoken of a great deal at my synagogue, our synagogue. I think a good example of this is someone not of a younger generation, but someone who is still a very young, fresh thinker. Hilary Putnam's recent book, a number of very important recent books in the last 10, 15 years, but the most recent one on Jewish philosophy as a guide to living, I think is the title. Now here's someone I remember. He describes himself as having long been an atheist and a materialist, a naturalist, a philosopher, something that Neil has described himself as well, and describes in an autobiographical note at the beginning of this book how he decided at one point, why should I do 20 minutes of transcendental meditation when I can actually daven in 20 minutes? Now, this may come as a revelation to some people that you can actually daven in 20 minutes, but on weekdays you can. It was a remarkable thing to read from someone like him, because here was someone saying, look, I have some need for something transcendent, and why shouldn't I try to do it through a tradition that I actually have some connection to? And then he goes on a journey over a couple of decades, and it gets to the point where he says the following, that he is willing to say that we often forget that the world has many levels of form, including the level of morally significant human action. The idea that everything can be reduced to the level of physics, I believe to be a fantasy. He is now stating that he is committed to finding some way to account for the transcendent, because it's necessary. Values may be created by human beings and human cultures, but I see them as made in response to demands that we do not create, that there is some reality out there, there is some godlike divine thing that is demanding things of us, and that we need to respond to that. He even says at one point that even though he doesn't take literally the idea of God being a wise, compassionate, personal kind of being, he sees it as a perfectly congenial kind of language to use, because it points us in the direction of something beyond us that has to have a reality to it. So someone like him is doing this. This is reflecting something I think very real in a culture that has for too long I think been seduced into thinking that everything can be somehow reduced to physics, and that we are made of something that is reflective already of a transcendent reality.
And Julie, is that the kind of answer you give the students who come to you and say, Rabbi, yeah, very nice, but what's true?
I mean this sincerely. The students who want to ask the question, what's true, they don't come to me, they go to the Chabad rabbi.
Because, you gotta change this, huh?
Because they understand that in terms of who I am as a rabbi and as a conservative rabbi, as a Hillel rabbi, I don't believe there is one truth. And in Judaism, I don't believe there is one truth for a person throughout the course of their lifetime. I think that's why I'm drawn to the pluralism of campus life. And I think, you know, what I found is that students, whether they identify when they come to me as a believer, an agnostic, or an atheist, are still trying to figure out what does that mean for me, and given that I really don't have that much great education around it, What does that mean in the context of the larger Jewish tradition? You know, these are students at Princeton studying things I can't even understand for their senior theses, and they want to engage in Jewish philosophy on that level. What I find is that the atheists, the hardcore atheists, which are really, I don't even know if I've met more than one or two of them. Seriously, most of the people seem to be agnostics. The hardcore atheists are the ones who need to see proof. And if it's not, you know, some kind of proof that they can see or point to in logically, they don't believe in God. But for the agnostics, I find that they really fall into two categories. And that's the majority of students I talk to. They identify as agnostics, even the ones who come to services, you know, on a regular basis. And the agnostics either feel that to be agnostic is to acknowledge that you can't prove that God exists, and they don't think you can be a believer and know that you have to take a leap of faith or you can't prove that God exists. You can maybe just have, you should be lucky to just have a sense of the transcendent. So either they identify agnostic because they can't prove beyond a reasonable doubt that God exists, or they identify as agnostic because they know that the big man in the sky doesn't speak to them, but they don't have any other language in which to describe God. And I've had the great privilege of meeting on a regular basis with two graduate students in particular who both agnostic from very different backgrounds. And the last time we spoke, the conversation we had was about how much it speaks to them to think of God as a predicate, to think of justice as a godly thing. And this sort of captures for them a way to connect with God. But when I asked them what you do with that sort of intellectually honest sense of the transcendent that's very abstract when it comes to having a personal relationship with God, we were all stumped, not just them. I was also stumped. And one of them said, I don't feel any loss for that, because if I don't know for sure God exists, like, why would I want to have, if I don't think of God in that kind of concrete way, why would I want to have a personal relationship with God in the sense that if I am suffering, God is listening and crying with me? And the other student who came from a much more traditional background, who you know, talked to God in a kind of Rabbi Nachman way for her first 18 years of life, said she feels that loss. But that loss is there for her. She can't kind of go back on that loss. There is no second naivete on that for her. So she's just looking for a way to describe transcendence and God that speaks to her and that is Jewish.
Well, since I agree with Neil Gilman that we have to put God back into Jewish conversation, I thought I would do the following in my contribution this evening. I'm first of all going to read you the passage from Neil's book, Doing Jewish Theology, which I liked the best, the passage that spoke most powerfully to me. And then following Neil's teaching in that passage, I'm going to do a Gilman-esque reading of this week's Parsha, B'Shalach. So the passage I like so much is a story that Neil tells when a friend of his was giving a seminar at Union Theological Seminary. They decided they wouldn't simply read biblical passages, they would act them out. And the passage that they decided to act out in class is the Akedah. So, I quote, "When our Abraham challenged God over the sheer cruelty and absurdity of God's demand, this God responded by insisting that he was God. He was omnipotent. He could demand whatever he wished, and Abraham had to obey. Our Abraham simply capitulated and fell silent." Says Neil Gilman, "This infuriated me, and with a passion that surprised me, I began to feel that this God had it all wrong." So the teacher, being a wise man, tells Neil, "Okay, now we're going to do the exercise over again, and you play God this time." So a person plays Sarah and really gives it to God for what God has just asked her husband Abraham to do. And Neil Gilman writes, "What I said in response was something along the following lines. Look, Sarah, everybody thinks that I'm omnipotent, that I get whatever I want to get here on earth. But in reality, I'm a total failure. I've created 20 generations of human beings since Adam, and have yet to find one human being whose loyalty to me is unquestioned.
for the ages, I desperately need to point to one person whose loyalty I was able to win. Please don't stop Abraham. Please let him go on his mission. I need Abraham. Trust me. He says he learned more from that class than he had from all the readings of the books he had done. And he continues and says, for the very first time, I understood Genesis 22 from God's perspective, not the anonymous narrator's. I had now entered God's persona as I understood it out of my own experience. And this is a key to Gillman theology, to understand God out of your own experience. Well, what I suggest is we take a look for just a second at this portion we're about to have, this portion of B'Shalach, and let's say that somehow the Torah needs us to work up to the point where the week after we can actually stand at Sinai, to take seriously this notion that God is in covenant with us. So what's required? So in no particular order, I'm going to tick off the following elements. Number one is a midrash in Besikta de Rav Kahana that David Hartman points out, which is that the rabbis make an analogy between the manna given in B'Shalach, the manna which tasted differently to every Israelite, and the commandments which have a different taste to every Israelite who receives them and tastes of them, performs them. Let's take another helpful example. How does the parsha begin? When God arranges for Pharaoh to send forth the Israelites, God doesn't leave them. V'lo nacham Elohim derech eretz plishtim. God doesn't lead them by way of the land of the Philistines, lest they see war and get frightened and repent of the decision to leave Egypt and want to go back. And there's a nice verbal pun the passage makes between lo nacham and the Israelites might yinachem. So what you see here is that God, in every single move God makes, has to do what the philosophers called accommodation. God has to worry about what human beings are going to think, or more importantly, fear at a particular moment. And so God has to accommodate the Exodus route to the Egyptians. Well, you know, if you studied your Rambam, there's probably no more important concept to understanding revelation in our tradition than accommodation. Torah nechtava b'lshon b'nei adam. Torah is written in human language in many respects. And so what we are trying to do is use human language to get from human experience to a conception of God that defies human experience and therefore defies human language. We're trying to point to what we can't capture, but even some of the pointing has to be done in a roundabout way because you can't do it directly. Let's take a couple other examples. There's an example that I'm particularly fond of in this portion. How do you give the Israelites an understanding of what it means for God to fulfill promises long ago? You do this by giving the Israelites themselves an experience of fulfilling promises made long ago. So right after the passage I just read, we find that Joseph had commanded the Israelites way back when to not leave Egypt without bringing his bones with them. And now we read, Vayikach Moshe tatzmot Yosef imo, that Moses takes Joseph's bones with him because Joseph had made the Israelites promise that they would do this. So the Israelites not only get to see God fulfilling a promise made to their ancestors long ago, they get to see themselves fulfilling a promise that their ancestors had made long ago, thereby perhaps enabling their experience to teach them a little bit more about God than they would otherwise understand. Finally, I would say that at the very beginning of the portion, the Israelites do have to fight a war, or rather, they get afraid at the sight of Pharaoh's army, so God fights for them. Hashem ilachem lachem v'atem tachrishun. You sit there and you watch God fight your battles. But at the end of the parsha, the Israelites are fighting God's battles with God's help from afar. This story about the hand of Moses, when it's up, they win, and when the hand goes down, they lose. And so two people hold up Moses' hand to make sure the army keeps winning. God somehow is going to guarantee that at the end of the day, the hand of the covenant is going to be on the ascendant. But it's not clear how God does this. God leads by way of a cloud by day and a fire by night, both of them quite ambiguous, both of them requiring human guides, both of them requiring human warriors, both of them requiring people to walk the walk. And God's leadership is always like that, rather ambiguous. And so in all these ways, you see a portion trying to get us inside the dilemma of God by beginning with our experience and getting us to think from our experience and go further than our experience. To me, this is exactly what Neil Gilman's teaching has been all about. And I resonate very much to his words when he argues in his book that if we're going to train Jewish leaders and rabbis especially, we need to make this part of their equipment. They need to be able to get inside the religious experience of their congregants and themselves in order to draw on that experience to bring people not only closer to their tradition, but closer to God. The means by which we do this are the myths and the metaphors and the stories like the ones I've just explained from B'Shalach, but the end game is to have them carrying on this story, living the story, observing the covenant. And I just wanted to say, as a leader of JTS, what a wonderful challenge it is to have Neil Gilman's words before me every single day, reminding me what our agenda at JTS has to be. All right, now we want to, Gordon, yes?
Could I just take that another step?
Please.
If I may. You had mentioned Kaplan before, and I'm reminded of it because of this wonderful demonstration of the imminence of God in the text and in seeing God reflected in and reflecting back to us human experience. So Kaplan in his later years began talking about a concept that he called transnaturalism, which was this idea that we are in a naturalistic world, but there is still the possibility of some transcendence within that world, that it's sometimes referred to as holism, that the whole somehow becomes more than the sum of its parts. And this is actually not a strange concept anymore in scientific circles and in scientific writing. And I think that Neil actually pointed us in an interesting direction this way in that book, The Death of Death. Because one of the things, Neil, that you were doing there, as you know, was trying to get us beyond this inherited dualism of body and soul and this idea that there is the physical world and if there's any transcendence at all, it's in some ethereal realm. The idea that God is not of an ethereal nature but is somehow immanent in us and in the world that we inhabit, in the world of our experience, is, I think, one of the keys not only to see it in the text and to be able to talk about, because on one level to say that God is somehow accommodating us is not the most inspiring view of God. It's a God who is somehow subservient to us. People have said, I've heard them say on many occasions, why would I worship a God like that? But if you take it in from a different angle, and the idea that God is actually reflected in the miracle that is us, that is inherent in a world that can be reduced down to little particles, and yet when seen large, when seen macroscopically, has the things that you would never predict from the little particles, moral principles, moral heroism, love, the kinds of things that make life meaningful. These are things that are, in fact, manifestations of that kind of transnaturalism. Art Green has written about evolution shouldn't be any kind of threat to any religious thinker, because evolution, as he puts it, is the greatest religious drama ever told. The little by little unfolding of the divine nature in the world of nature. Neil has actually written about this. I wrote down one of his phrases, which was that in a Heschelian way, he says he has a radical amazement about how biological processes in the brain can lead to a concept of God. And I would say not only to a concept of God, but really reflect a kind of reality of God. Douglas Hofstadter, who writes a great deal about artificial intelligence, puts it in a somewhat different way, but really the same thing. We are miracles, all of us, of self-reference, that somehow we become self-conscious beings in this chain of evolution is one of these great miracles. So it is possible going forward, I think, to recapture a serious idea of God without violating some of the things that we perforce have to have respect for, which is what's our science tells us about the world. One of my favorite quotes, I just had occasion to mention it to a colleague yesterday, is something that James Audubon is said to have said once, that when the bird and the book disagree, you always believe the bird. And we can construct all kinds of theologies, but that's why there's the primacy of religious experience. What people actually feel within themselves about a divine presence is more important than what any systematic theology will tell you.
I just want to say one quick thing, which is I don't think you can underestimate the degree to which people, you know, amcha and young people in particular need permission to talk about certain things. So while I would say that religious experience is primary, what I find in my work on campus is that students are stopped from even speaking about religious experience if they think that there's only certain ways that they're allowed to speak about it. And that's where I think doing theology comes in terms of engaging students and congregants and people in conversations about the translation of that experience to metaphors that they either come up with on their own that are grounded in Jewish tradition or aren't. And you know, so I don't want to underestimate the importance of conversations about God and theology as a gateway for students to even acknowledge their religious experience.
Exactly, and you get into the portion of the week the way that I just tried to do, and you see that it wasn't Neil Gilman who invented the idea of seeking truth via stories and myths and metaphors. The Torah's been there a long time before us. So I think what we got to do is confront Chabad on the grounds of tradition and Torah, namely, there is a truth here. We're not saying there's not a truth here. It's just maybe a more complex truth than the one that you're pushing. But the Torah didn't believe in simple truth either. We've got the Torah on our side here. The Torah wanted simple truth. It wouldn't have told stories as fantastic as these stories that have had Jews thinking about truth for 3,000 years and not able to arrive at simple conclusions. But there is truth there. Well, this would not be a Neil Gilman evening if we kept the monopoly up here on the stage. So we would like the moment for others to now join in the questions and answers and help us in doing our own Jewish theology. There are two microphones here in the aisles, and we invite people to come toward them and ask their questions and make their comments.
Is it that science lacks?
You don't want to just come back on the 17th. Gordon, you want to tackle that in quickly, or what should we say, meaning, purpose, transcendence?
I don't think science has to lack anything. First of all, you know, as many of you probably know, Maimonides thought that you could not reach any kind of religious consummation in your life without being adept at mathematics and physics and astronomy, and that this is part of what it is to appreciate God's world. And how can you appreciate God without knowing something and having a curiosity about the world and the truths that are laid out before us? So the idea that science is in some way antithetical to the religious quest was completely alien to him. And I think, judging by all the yeshiva bachurs who were in the departments of chemistry and physics when I was in college doing PhDs there, I guess it wasn't alien to them either. What it can lack is exactly this sense of a transcendent. What it can lack, where it can go wrong, is where it does what example of Hillary Putnam getting eventually beyond the idea that everything can somehow be reduced to scientific equations, and the idea that that there are things in the world that are quite real that are not so reducible, he says, is to him now a commonplace, and the rest was always a kind of a fantasy. Scientists, more than anyone else, should be falling into fantasies. And if there is a good recognition that that there is within the scientific worldview a sufficient wonder and sufficient transcendence that between the what we see on the microscopic level and the macroscopic level and the ways in which we experience as total human beings, even though we know that we are made of matter, this in itself is a reflection of the wonders of the Creator.
Yes, please.
First, with all due respect, I'm a secular person. I graduated from a modern Orthodox high school in Jerusalem, but don't blame them for my opinions. I have some questions here. Number one, the question is addressed to the professor from Hillel. You talked about the ethics. Well, we have the ethical culture society for that. So the question is, you know, what would you tell these students that Judaism has to offer, which is different, in non-religious terms? Because, as you said, these students want answers on the level of ethics. So what would you say, in what way is Judaism superior to what a very secular society has to offer, or to what the ethical cultural society has to offer? That's question number one.
And if, we'll give you one more. We'll give you one more.
No, I would follow it up and say that, again, I address it to the same professor. The problem is...
I got a promotion.
That's all right, but the salaries today, you deserve it. And the second question, really the problem is that all advances in science are based on modeling and hypothesis which have nothing to do with religion. So therefore, if you can point out, not to some sort of philosophical speculations, but if you can point out to an actual model which explains reality, which can be based on religious assumptions, you would have greater effect amongst the students. But until such time, it's poetry. It's beautiful words.
All right, we'll let Rabbi Roth tackle this one.
So as I said before, when I talk to atheist students, I find that it's like, in a way, we're talking two different languages. I think some people either have the disposition or the philosophical belief that the primary system of meaning is one that has models and hypotheses in science. And so in a sense, I don't have an answer to your second question, but I will say that I think that Judaism, that I as a Hillel rabbi need an answer to that second question. I wonder if the secular humanists have it, the Jewish secular humanists. I wonder, you know, I can't tell you how many of my students are curious about secular humanism. I mean, they go out to coffee with me and then they go to the library to look at that section of books, which is the only time students have really done that, is on the topic of secular humanism. So I think that we need not only a religious answer to the myth that offers cosmic meaning, but also an atheist one. But back to your first question, I would say two things to answer your question of what does Judaism offer that is different. You asked both what's different and what's superior. I am not comfortable telling you what's superior about Judaism. That's just not what I'm interested in. I can tell you what's different, though. And to me, Judaism is like speaking French in the sense that it's a language. And, you know, there are things that you can say in French. I don't even know French, so I should have probably chose a different language. There are things you can say in French that you can't really say precisely in any other language. And a language itself is a way of organizing how we name things, how we make meaning. And Judaism is my native language, along with English. And so I want to at least understand what it means to be conversant, if not fluent, in that language. So I think that what's interesting about accessing that Jewish language is seeing how it, in a particular way, defines the meaning of life. I happen to think we have a lot of really powerful, great answers, some that maybe I favor or in the privacy of my own home would say are superior to some other answers that are out there. But primarily, what I believe is that it's my language. The other thing I think that's missing from a secular definition of meaning is holiness. And maybe that's circular, but for me, holiness is different from meaning. It's an added layer. I could find it meaningful to be respectful of my parents, but it's holy to be respectful of my parents in Judaism if I have some sense that it's part of a covenant with my people, it's part of a covenant through the generations, and it's part of relating to something transcendent. So language, my language, and holiness.
Thank you.
I would say briefly that, and I think Neil Gilman would say, our job is to get these students inside the experience of the community and the tradition and have them asking questions from inside that experience and that community and not standing on the outside posing these philosophical questions from a distance. Next question, please. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't see you over there, but we'll come back to you in 1 second.
Okay. Me? Okay.
Please.
Thank you. The question is really similar on similar lines, but it comes from my experience of speaking with a young man who was on his way to college, and he professed to be an atheist, and he continued to tell me that he thought that, you know, marrying someone Jewish was, not only was he not interested, but would never do it, because that's part of the problem of the world. And no matter what I said about what you said about the language of Judaism, we have a way of relating, he said, it's just a chance that I happen to have two Jewish parents and it really doesn't mean anything. And I respond to both what, Gordon, what you said about the passage from the Dybbuk, that you said that, well, we used to be able to say those things in that language, but we can't do that anymore because it's really, you didn't use the words, but it's not politically correct, and we can't, you didn't use those words, but you did say that we can't, it speaks about something that is better.
It may not be politically correct, but that wasn't, it was much more than political incorrectness. We basically feel that it's simply incorrect.
That's incorrect. Okay. Yes. Right. Yes. Okay, that it's incorrect. That's fine. There are probably those here who feel it is correct still, but okay, so we can't see that as correct. And then you said, I think the gentleman who just spoke was responding to you saying God doesn't care if we eat a cheeseburger, but he cares if we're good people. And this individual that you deal with all the time and that I had the opportunity to deal with are the kinds of people that we deal with all the time. And I see younger kids who are, they finish their bar bat mitzvahs and they're in high school and they have become so disillusioned and they're anti-religious because it's against everything else that they know. And I don't know where to go.
And we used to think they'd grow out of it, and now we know they won't. Let's go, rabbis.
First of all, I want to say, I think maybe I was misunderstood a bit. I don't just think, when I said God doesn't care about eating cheeseburgers, I wasn't trying to say God doesn't care about ritual things. He only cares about ethical things. He only cares about being good. I think God cares about the bigger picture. God also cares about us acknowledging that our life is a sacred gift. So I may not have given all my examples about the bigger picture, but I did not intend to make a divide between the ritual and the ethical.
But does he care if we're uniquely Jewish and do Jewish things like keeping kosher and Shabbat and all those things that make us Jewish?
Well, let me tell you a little story. There, I have a couple of things I want to say about this. So before I get to the story, first of all, it's more than a language. Language is a very important part of it. But language is the stuff out of which narratives are made, out of which stories are made. Heschel spent his life and career arguing for the importance of understanding how dependent upon and how subservient to Agadah halacha is. That a Jewish way of life will make no sense unless it has a framing narrative to it. Nothing, no normative life makes sense. It is idiosyncratic if there is no framing narrative, if there's no story that you feel a part of that is going to give that way of life meaning. There are many, many different narratives in this world, and there are many narratives that are intended to be reaching out to and expressing a yearning for God and to bring God into one's life. The Jewish narrative is not the only one. I think that's what it means to say I could try transcendental meditation, but why shouldn't I try the morning minyan? I don't have to take everything literally there, but it brings me into a storyline, and it provides some kind of anchor and some kind of meaning. So one of the answers to the question of why do this at all is because what explanatory power exactly does atheism have? What does atheism explain? It is a rejection of other explanations, and some explanations do need to be rejected. Right? If someone says to someone after a tragedy, go check your mezuzahs, that's an explanation that needs to be rejected.
I agree.
But if the answer is atheism, you know how many times I have had people come into my office and say, Rabbi, I don't believe in God anymore? And I'll say, okay. Describe to me the God you no longer believe in. And after they do, the answer is, you may not have expected to be hearing this from me, but I don't believe in that God either. So atheism, you know, we use it as a kind of an all-encompassing term, but atheism is relative to a particular image of God. Part of this narrative that Chancellor Eisen has talked about the asking of questions and the formulation of doubt that comes out in these very complex stories is what it means to be part of that kind of an ongoing storyline. Now I'm going to tell you the story that happened in this building. Well, years ago, in those 8 years that I was the dean of the rabbinical school, I was also what came along with the deal is that I was the advisor to our students here when they were participating in the theological student dialogues with students from other seminaries in the New York area. So there was an evening when students from here, from Union Theological, from General Theological Seminary, from St. Vladimir's Orthodox Seminary in Yonkers, from the St. Joseph Seminary, and from New York Theological Seminary were all together, and Hebrew Union College. And they were all discussing the subject of chosenness. The JTS students were making a presentation. You've never seen people so afraid and so defensive in your life. Until an African-American woman from studying for the ministry at New York Theological Seminary got up and said, I don't understand why you're being so defensive. I feel chosen. I hope everyone in the world feels chosen. You don't feel chosen? You're apologetic about it? She said, heck, if you don't feel chosen, what damn good are you? Right? Which was her way of saying, I think, if you're not willing to be part of some particular narrative, what are you, some generic human being? And if your default option is atheism, so what exactly are you explaining? If you're in a storyline that's trying to give meaning and give explanation to things in the world, you may be wrong, but you can always change your mind and continue the storyline that way. But if you opt out of the storyline, it's kind of that element of life is kind of closed off to you.
We have time for one more question. Take it.
I want to just bring this line to a particular point of focus. With all the multiplicities of pathways, of languages, of narratives, of chosennesses, and so on, is there any sense possible for us today to make of the concept of idolatry, of avodah zarah, of believing in a false god, or worshiping a false god, if all of these are metaphors that in the end all converge into the great oneness.
I could just say yes, but I'll turn it over to Rabbi Roth and see what she says.
The last time I sat on this stage, I was receiving the talit by which I was ordained as a rabbi, and I only agreed to speak on this panel with the condition that they would not take this ordination away, whatever questions I was asked.
You're safe.
I'm safe?
Yeah.
To me, when I think of idolatry and Judaism, I think of values. We hold false values more precious than God, like achievement and the pursuit of materialism and money, and I think that's a conversation about idolatry we need to be having more often. I also think that if we understand metaphors precisely as metaphors, we're reminding ourselves that we never really can fully capture a sense of God, and that we have to be careful not to say that the language in which we use to talk about God is God, because we really don't know. But with regard to all of the different religions and metaphors, you know, ultimately pointing to different parts of the same elephant, I think elephant is the metaphor, there's the elephant in the room. You know, ultimately, it's hard for me to believe if there is one God that connects everything or a very whole of this holiness, whole more transcendent than the parts, that we have the truth and nobody else has the truth. But to me, that's not idolatry. That's being a good faith neighbor in a global world that's interfaith. And I think that it's not an accident that the story you told, Gordon, was one told in the context of interfaith dialogue, both because I think these conversations allow us to sharpen what's particular about our Jewish way of thinking about God and our religion, and because sometimes our more traditional or fundamentalist or unapologetic Christian or Muslim or other faith leaders allow us to claim as liberals truths that maybe we're afraid to claim sometimes. And I also think that for the young generation today, some of them only access Judaism when it's with other Jews. There are students who come to Shabbat dinner at Princeton Hillel on Friday nights only because they can bring their non-Jewish friends with them. There are students who participate in programs only because their dialogues with Muslim students on campus. And so I think we have to be unafraid to embrace that pluralism that exists in the world, and also to speak as liberal Jews about the truth and the power of our own beliefs. I'll just end by saying that I had a profound realization before I wrote that Yom Kippur sermon that I sent to you. Next time I'm gonna be more careful not to send you sermons. that I would be more likely to recommend to a student that they go see a particular movie than that they practice Shabbat, when that experiment for me of taking on the practice of Shabbat has become the single most meaningful practice in Judaism for me. It gives me a vacation, a rest, a sense of higher meaning and purpose every week that is even building on what I had as a kid growing up with Shabbat dinner. And that's a problem, because we should not be unafraid to share our passion for the power of what we discover in our own tradition.
You mentioned Will Herberg before as a great influence on Neil, who he clearly was. In a way, this is a perfect question for us to turn to Neil to hear about, because so much of what he has written about myths and metaphors has been a way of steering us away from what he thinks is a flirtation with idolatry. Something that Herberg was very concerned about as well. The one thing that I would say, I have my own homely metaphor for this. I can't help it. This is, you know, from Bronx High School of Science days. I always think of the tangent curve, and you know the asymptote that it's getting closer and closer to is real. It's not there, but you never really get there. It is a process of getting closer and closer and closer. It's a metaphor for me of a kind of a yearning and a belief and a conviction that there is a reality beyond us. There is something divine in the world. But as soon as you think you have gotten your hands on it, you have violated the rules. And that is, in some sense, a definition of idolatry for me. Not to ever be on the curve is, in some sense, a definition of opting out of religion entirely and losing some of the richness and the fun of being part of that storyline.
We asked several colleagues of Neil Gilman to say a few words about him, and I'm going to bring him up here with a passage from Rabbi Joel Roth. The Gemara in Ketubot says that when students of a specific mentor found themselves no longer in his ongoing presence, they called themselves orphaned or bitterly orphaned. My dear friend Neil, with each year that passes from now on, this institution will have more and more yitomim, orphans, whose loss of not having you as their mentor and rabbi will be immeasurable. Whether they know it or not, that is the void that your retirement will create. Well, we're going to try to stave off this retirement here by having Neil Gilman come up and respond to the questions of the evenings. I present to you Neil Gilman.
To begin by just saying thank you to the Chancellor, to Gordon and Julie.
I'll start all over again. I wanted to say thank you to the Chancellor, to Gordon and Julie, to Tom Cajetan, who's here someplace, but without whom this whole evening would never have taken place. And of course, to the Rapaport family for bringing all of us together tonight. My retirement and intimations of my mortality have prompted me to recall the trajectory of my career and of my thinking since 1953, when, as an undergraduate at McGill, and in the wake of my encounter with Will Herberg, I began to do Jewish theology for the first time. Now that review locates me squarely in this institution, because I have studied and taught in these halls since the fall of 1954, which is a very long time. So there is much to evaluate. And I've asked myself more and more, what role did the culture of JTS play in the evolution of my thinking? And I want to say honestly here, in the presence of the Chancellor, that my remarks tonight should be understood as a form of teshuva, of repentance. I did not know what the Chancellor was going to say about the role of theology in the Jewish Theological Seminary, but I have far too often toured the country saying there wasn't much theology at the Jewish Theological Seminary. And in retrospect, from this perspective, at this point in my life, looking back, that was far too categorical a claim. It was irresponsible. I probably, when I said it, qualified it in some way or other, but I never met the qualification, and the categorical statement I did mean. And I now realize that what was needed was a much more nuanced evaluation. I now feel that there was a great deal of theology in the halls of JTS, in the thinking and writing of my teachers and of my colleagues, but unfortunately, very little of it trickled down to the curriculum and to the classrooms of the rabbinical school where I was studying. And this culture that was just in the air, these theological ruminations, which were in the building, I believed, demanded that I pursue it. You know, I always tell graduate students that nobody ever gives you an education on a silver platter. You have to go and create your own education, which means you have to find the teachers, the mentors, the books, the courses that are going to give you what you need to do what you want to do with your scholarly life. And I now realize that I imbibed this culture of theology, not because it was handed to me in the classroom, but because I was thirsty for it and because I ran around looking for it. It was not served up to me. And in a sense, I think I created my education, but I created it out of what was available to me, out of resources that were available to me here. Everybody has mentioned Will Herberg, and I must do that also, because when I walked into Hillel at McGill in, I think, the spring of 1952, I heard for the very, very first time a Jewish statement that was engaging, intellectually exciting, intriguing, and existentially very demanding. That moment changed my life. I hung around, spoke to Will, followed him around Montreal for 3 days, and at the end of that period, I said, I have to be a serious Jew. And then I determined that I was going to spend my life doing what Herberg did, namely to teach Jewish philosophy. And that is why to this day, especially at Hillel, but not only at Hillel, when I speak at educational institutions around the country in different guises, my fantasy is always that somewhere out there, sitting in the halls in front of me, some student who wandered in for the worst of reasons, or the best of reasons. I wandered in because there was a woman I was trying to date, and she was going, and she said that, you know, she wanted me to come with her, so I did. I'm convinced that God put her on earth in order to get me into the field of Jewish philosophy.
That's idolatry.
Okay. That was before I met Herberg. that was followed shortly thereafter with a conversation with Harry Ostrin Wolfson in the bowels of Widener at Harvard. And I said, I want to do Jewish philosophy. He says, Mr. Gillman, you're a sweet guy, but you don't know anything. I said, I know. So he said, so go to JTS. I said, what's JTS? And that's how it all began. So Wolfson sent me here. And I came in here in the fall of 1954. I was a confused, unsophisticated Rosenzweigian existentialist who was at the same time a fundamentalist on halachic issues simply because I didn't know there was a problem. and that's where I began here in 54. And what I soon discovered here was, first of all, that the revelation at Mount Sinai ever happened. Second, that Torah was a compilation of various documents written over centuries by different people, put together sometime around Ezra, with ample borrowings from Mesopotamia, from Near Eastern religions. And that halacha was expected, that, God help us, we should not be caught coming out of, it was then Shopwell, now it's D'Agostino's, at 110th Street on Shabbat with a package of groceries. So Sinai never happened, but halacha is demanded, and theology, God talk, was nowhere to be found. There was no attempt to reconcile all of this, no attempt to put it together, and the wisest course to pursue while we were students was just to shelve the entire issue and just not think about it. But then there was Mordechai Kaplan. Kaplan insisted that we must integrate theology in ideology and practice. And he did it. And he had gone through that same struggle, I now know, and ended up with what Kaplan ended up with. And it all got condensed one day in class, in my second year, when he said, and I've quoted this so often, Mr. Gillman, Judaism is whatever the Jewish people say it is. And I was deeply offended. And I said to myself, that's all there is? And he said, well, that's a great deal. And I quoted him in a paper, and I was sitting quietly in my room one afternoon, and I suddenly got a phone call. In those days, you didn't have telephones in your room. Your room was buzzed, and you ran down the hall and picked up the phone in the hall. And there I was. Mr. Gillman, yes. Mordechai Kaplan. Yes, Professor. Are you free? I said, did you want to talk to me? He said, yes. He said, why don't you get into a cab and come over to my apartment? I walked into the apartment, and I saw my paper laid out on the dining room table. There wasn't a square inch without red markings. And unerringly, he focused on this sentence. He says, when did I say that? I said, about 2 months ago. Well, he said, it's a problem, I guess. I said, I thought there was a problem. Well, he said, so let's talk about it. We spent the afternoon, I in his living room or in his dining room, talking with Mordechai, me, a pitcher from Quebec who didn't know a damn thing, was sitting in the room with Mordechai Kaplan, talking about the whole issue of where does Judaism come from? Where does religion come from? Where is authority to be found? He integrated theology, ideology, practice. And he challenged me in a way that I needed to be challenged desperately. And Kaplan became a role model, and my conversion to religious naturalism had begun. I began to teach in the 1960s, and I remember feeling that I could no longer teach theology as I had been taught. What had I been taught? Basically, Jewish intellectual history. In my years at JTS, nobody had ever said to me, Mr. Gillman, write a personal theology. What do you believe now, today? Nobody had ever asked me to do that. I did it as part of my entrance examinations to the rabbinical school, but that was 2 years before, and I had learned an awful lot since then. And I shudder at the pain that I would have felt if I had been forced to write it each year during my rabbinical school career. And now that I assign this regularly to all of my students, they know that, and I say, I know it's going to hurt like hell, but it's good for you, and write it. And to this day, I keep getting personal theologies written by students who were graduated 25, 30 years ago. Every 3 or 4 years, they just write it again. Nobody had ever asked me to do that, but I was convinced that I was one of the important things I learned from my teachers was not was how not to teach. So I taught Jewish intellectual history, you know, concepts of God from Moshe Rabbeinu up until, I don't know, up until Moses Mendelssohn or something like that. But I always stopped before the 20th century because I was scared to go any further. And then I had a group of incredibly bright rabbinical students. Two of them I remember, Ed Feinstein, who's now a wonderful rabbi in California, and Danny Gordas, who one day said to me, now that you've taught us what everybody else believes, Professor Gillman, what do you believe? And I said, me? And I realized that if I was going to ask them to do personal theologies, I would have to ask them to do myself. And I also felt that I had to teach theology in such a way that it integrated not only theology, ideology, and practice, but also the rest of their curriculum, namely how they teach, how this institution understood Torah, and also the decisions of the RA Law Committee. I had to teach theology, ideology, practice, which incorporated biblical criticism and also incorporated the fact that now a Kohen can marry a divorcee, even though the Torah says no. Fortunately, at this stage, when I began to think that now I have to put together a personal theology, my work at Columbia intervened, and I encountered Paul Tillich. Judaism and Modern Man was the first book in my canon, my personal canon. The second was Paul Tillich's Dynamics of Faith. I read Dynamics of Faith in a white heat, and suddenly everything became clear. I think I was prepared for Tillich because of my work with Kaplan, but the issue of the reigning issues, which has bothered me ever since, and the vocabulary which I have used ever since to talk about what I do and what I believe, the epistemological issues, the nature of religious language, the use of metaphor in theology, the whole notion of myth, of a broken myth, and of second naivete, all of these terms became crucial and central to my being able to articulate a personal theology. And at that point, I felt I had the right to expect something from my students as well. Tillich gave me a language to recover a coherent theology once I could no longer believe in the historicity of Sinai and in the literalness of revelation of Torah. Now, my JTS experience enters into the picture. First generation was Kaplan and Heschel. I was lucky. I came here at a time when they were both actively teaching. We had Heschel Monday morning and Kaplan Tuesday morning. And Heschel taught from 9 to 9:45. Notice, Monday morning, 9 to 9:45. The graveyard shift for an academician for two semesters. And Heschel taught Maimonides one semester and Yehuda Halevi, the Kuzari, the second semester. Tuesday morning at 10:30 in Watt Kaplan. And whatever Kaplan was supposed to teach, it always was Kaplan. He didn't even make an attempt to teach Maimonides and Halevi. He taught Kaplan. From Kaplan, I learned method. I consider myself theologically, methodologically a Kaplanian. I'm accused of being a Reconstructionist, and I say names will never hurt me, but I'm not a Reconstructionist. But I am a Kaplanian methodologically. and from Heschel, not so much from Maimonides and Kuzari. Those were not the most fruitful courses that I ever took here at the seminary. I mean, 45 minutes, 50 minutes on a Monday morning at 9 o'clock, nobody was terribly eager to do serious philosophy. But I began to read Heschel carefully and slowly. And I read God in Search of Man, and I read the prophets, and I began to understand that what was happening here was that Kaplan may have taught me method, but Heschel taught me substance. That I could no longer speak of God again without talking about the divine pathos. That the image of a God, and very much echoing what the chancellor said earlier, a vulnerable God, a God who was, as Heschel said, a colossal failure. Heschel had this gig. He would go, Adam and Eve, failure. Cain and Abel, two nice guys, went to the finest private schools, went to Dalton. One killed the other. Another failure, right? And then the generation of the flood. And he went through all of this stuff. God never got the success that a supposedly omnipotent, transcendent God should have easily earned. But we read Tanakh as if we've accepted the conventional view of an all-powerful, transcendent God who does what he wants, who gets what he wants. Parenthetically, this is a God, of course, who also causes earthquakes where 200,000 people are killed, or doesn't stop it. But that's another issue. Pathos from Heschel, an entirely different way of thinking of God, an entirely different way of reading Torah. Because you read Torah not as conventional American theology tells you to, but in terms of what's there, read the text. This image of a God who fails, who is rejected, who yearns eternally, who says, hit me again. And this is the God we daven to. And then this whole notion that faith is an ontological presupposition. I puzzled over that one for a long time until I realized, and this is quite recent, that this was Heschel's version of second naivete, that it's a regressive moment in our epistemological struggle to go back to a more primitive state of thinking about God, where imagination, the kind of issues that Gordon Tucker was talking about just a few moments ago, where imagination, poetry, myth play a role. My frustration with Heschel is that he never said all of this, but it was there. And it was identical to Ricoeur's second naivete, and to the guy who eventually wrote my PhD dissertation on Gabriel Marcel, who had this whole notion of a secondary reflection, a reflection that takes you below the critical phase, that recapitulates, recovers, returns to an earlier state where God can be present. All of this from Heschel. The second generation, from Heschel to Yochanan Mafs. Yochanan, Alav HaShalom, was not teaching when I was there. He was a colleague in rabbinical school, and then he began to teach, but I never had him as a teacher. But I have since reread and reread the two major books that he's published in English, Love and Joy and The Personhood of God. My favorite story about that second is that I walked into West Side Judaica and I asked Noach, as he calls himself, Noach, do you have the personhood of God? He looks around and he says, tell Rabbi Gillman that it's out of print, but we'll get the personhood of Hashem sometimes next week. And then he said, Rabbi Gillman, why are you smiling? I said, because you're lovely, because you're delightful. Of course it's the personhood of Hashem. But it was Muffs who took from Heschel the notionhood that God is incredibly human. If you put together the metaphors, the kaleidoscope of metaphors that appear throughout the Tanakh, what comes together at the end is a sense of a God who is totally human. It's a God who changes his mind, a God who's frustrated, a vulnerable God, a disappointed God, an angry God, an upset God. I mean, all emotions that are familiar to us. Muffs made Heschel explicit. I sometimes feel that he took the Heschelian envelope and stretched it much longer than Heschel himself might have done it, but sometimes one generation can never do the whole story. Sometimes you have to leave something for the next generation. Third step, from Muffs to Steve Geller and to Ben Summer. I was lucky. They asked me to team teach. Biblical theology with Steve Geller for 2 years, and then when with Ben Summer for 1 year. I can't tell you how enriching team teaching can be. Forget about the fact that I tried to teach anything. Forget about my teaching. I sat there entranced as Steve, in his inimitable, you know, burly, girly, you know, grizzly bear kind of way, just talked. And the whole thing became incredibly clear. These, to me, were invaluable learning experience. And the crucial step to me was nothing that Steve said on his own, but when I pushed him. And I pushed him to go beyond Muffs. And I said, okay, these guys who wrote Deuteronomy 4 created an image of God that was so entirely human. The human face of God, Muffs speaks of. Where did they get this from? How did they know how to portray God? And finally, after pushing and pushing, Steve Geller said in class one day, and that was my great moment of triumph, he said, because they understood themselves as human beings. They looked in the mirror, and they were able to see God in themselves, and themselves in God. And that's where I first said, theology recapitulates anthropology. It's the ultimate triumph of Kaplan's naturalism. And from Ben Summer, so human is this God that he even has a body. He has lots of bodies. And what astonishes me is that in this day and age, I said, boy, Ben, when that book gets published, you should see the uproar that's going to take place at the seminary. What uproar? I mean, if Kaplan had tried to say it, he would have been decapitated. Ben is walking around teaching, and he's absolutely fine. My suspicion is that nobody read the book. It's an incredibly important book. So there's a direct line from Heschel to Muffs to Geller and Summer. Indeed, paradoxically, from Kaplan to Heschel, to Muffs, to Geller, to Summer, because on some crucial issues, Heschel and Kaplan are not that far apart. And I would like to stretch it even farther, and I know this is a stretch, and the Chancellor will forgive me, from Solomon Schechter to Kaplan, to Heschel, to Muffs, to Geller, and Summer. Solomon Schechter, because Schechter hired Mordechai Kaplan, and in an 1898 piece called Historical Judaism, Schechter wrote about discussing that it was the human community who was responsible for canonizing Tanakh. It was human beings who decided what got into Tanakh and what was kept out. And then he has this incredible sentence, and boy, if I ever get Schechter alone, I would say, what did you mean by this? It was the human community, Jews, Catholic Israel, who canonized the Tanakh, and then he says, but God invariably agrees with the wishes of Israel. Now, mull that one over a little bit. Schechter hired Kaplan, and Kaplan, incidentally, recommended the hiring of Heschel, although I think he lived to forget to regret it. But all of these resources were available to me at JTS. What they did not do was handed to me in a silver platter. I remember once asking Dr. Finkelstein, did you know what Franz Rosenzweig wrote about Revelation? He said, sure. I said, well, why didn't you ever tell me about it? Why didn't you ever teach it? He said, and if I had said it and if I had taught it, would you have agreed with me? I said, no. He said, you had to find it yourself. The school was a theological hothouse. I would add the words in French, malgré lui. I could not avoid theology simply because this institution assembled a group of great minds who were prepared to confront the central issues of human existence as they emerged out of our texts. That meant doing theology. And finally, in my last most extensive teaching experience, I team taught with Steve Brown, who was then the dean of the Davidson School. We taught a course called Translating Jewish Theology. There are people in this room who took that course. I taught theology. Steve taught teaching Gilman. And I must say that what that course did for me was force me to articulate concisely and clearly a coherent Jewish theology. Finally, lest you think that this entire talk has been an academic exercise, for me it has, but it's much more. I want to conclude with three pleas. First, acknowledge the indispensability of theology. I'm nuts. I got hooked on philosophy and theology because I was a philosophy major and I met Herberg. But it's hard for me to understand how in this modern day and age, anybody can be a serious Jew without some kind of underlying theology. Acknowledge that, but really acknowledge it by allotting theology, the study and the teaching of theology, faculty time, curricular time, by cultivating a theological culture in the institution. Two, team teaching is incredibly important. I would have lost so much if I have not spent 2 years in the classroom with Steve Geller, 1 year with Ben Summer, and then 9 years with Steve Brown. It brings different concerns, and it forces the teachers to articulate, forget about the benefit to the students. It's incredibly important to the faculty. And understand, third, that there is a theologian at the heart of every human being. Look, there's a theologian in the heart of every human being. And we have to begin not by telling them what to believe, but by asking them, what is it that they already do believe? I spent a day last week at the Gann Academy in Boston. I spent the entire day from 8 in the morning to 5 at night teaching various classes, speaking to individual students, big groups, small groups, the faculty. As I was walking out to get the train back to New York, a young woman stepped up to me and said, you know, I read about everything that you wrote about second naivete and sacred fragments. She says, can you tell me? I will give you a passage from the Haggadah. Tell me if that's an example of second naivete. I said, what is it? She says, and she quotes from the Haggadah, Hayav kol adam lirot et atzmo ke'ilu hu yatza mimitzrayim. Everybody is responsible to see himself, herself, as if I came out of Egypt. And I smiled and said, you know, I've always puzzled about that passage. It's clearly silly on the face of it, but the ki'ilu, she says, yeah, yeah. What does the ki'ilu mean? I said, it's as if. So she says, as if we came out of Egypt. She said, that's what I understand you as meaning when you talk about a post-critical second naivete. I said, you know, I have never thought of that example, but you're absolutely right. So then she says, this is from a high school student, then she says, well, what about the famous Midrash that says we were all at Sinai? Every Jew from every generation was at Sinai. Is that second naivete? I said, well, there's no ki'ilu there. Yeah, she says, isn't that interesting? Why is there a ki'ilu we were in Egypt, but there's no ki'ilu where we were at Sinai? And I looked at her and I said to her, Rachel, that's why I want to teach theology, is because I want to have students who ask me those kinds of questions. I haven't the faintest idea, but email me and I'll get back to you. She did. And I did. Thank you so much for coming tonight.
It's great to be in the presence of one of America's great theologians. Blessed is God who shares God's wisdom with human beings. I want you all to know that we are going to be establishing the Neil Gilman Fellowship for the Study of Theology at the Jewish Theological Seminary. And I hope you all help us in that regard. Neil, it's been great. Thank you very much. Thank you to the panelists, Julian Gordon, and thank you all for being with us.